This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. The title of today's episode is Tips to Avoid the All or Nothing Case Presentation Dilemma. I'm excited to share that information with you. I think that's something that many of our listeners can identify with. And I'm going to share some solutions that will help you avoid that all or nothing possibility. It's not your intent, but sometimes that's how people hear it. So I think you'll enjoy this podcast episode. Hey, before we get to the content of this podcast, a couple announcements to make. Coming up, about a month from the time this episode is published, we have our next masterclass. That masterclass is titled Specific Plan to Reduce Your Overhead to 60% or Less. That masterclass is April 25th. It is 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time, 3 hours. You'll get 3 hours of CE credit. If you struggle with overhead, if your overhead's higher than 60%, I want to strongly encourage you to come to that masterclass. I'm going to give you a blueprint to follow to get your overhead to 60% or less. Lots of useful information you can apply the next day in your practice. It's done in a live stream format. It's live. However, it is done virtually, so you can attend from the comfort and convenience of your home or office, not have to have any of that hassle. But it is live, so you can ask me questions, and I run it more like a workshop than a lecture. If you'd like to register, our masterclasses do sell out. I'd like to encourage you to register for that if you are interested. Go to thrivingdentist.com/masterclass. Very inexpensive tuition is less than $100. You get 3 hours of CE credits. Come join us if you'd like to learn how to get your overhead to 60% or less. Hope to see you there. Second announcement is we have a returning guest. If you're a regular listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you'll recognize his voice. It's Dr. Pavel Krestev. And he's going to talk to you about some things he's learned in providing endodontic treatment. Dr. Krestev has a practice that focuses on things like dental implants and cosmetic dentistry, complex restorative dentistry, but he also does a fair amount of endo. And he's going to talk to you in this episode about apical gauging. Now, one more comment I want to make about Dr. Krestev is that he produces the same episode that you're going to hear in this tip. He does that in video form. And we have that on our YouTube channel, the Thriving Dentist YouTube channel. If you'd like to see him delivering this tip, go to YouTube, type in Thriving Dentist, and you'll see the episode, and you'll see Dr. Pavel Krestev. Anyway, with no further ado, here's Dr. Pavel Krestev on apical gauging.
Hello, my dear friends, and once again, thank you to the Thriving Dentist organization for giving me once again an opportunity to share a clinical tip with you guys regarding a certain aspect of dentistry. So just a little history. I'm a general practitioner. My practice is largely implant and aesthetically based. I do quite a bit of prosthetic cases and a decent amount of implants. But endodontics is a hobby. It's a hobby that's growing with my career in terms of the time I spent practicing dentistry. And I seem to be learning more and more, especially these days with the advances in metallurgy and the different materials that that we use in endodontics in terms of the way they are made. Having said that, today my topic is going to be apical gauging. And apical gauging, I think, is very important because Mother Nature creates a tooth in many cases, as we know. Teeth have multiple roots. And the apices, or the exits of where the nerves, the pulps, and their contents exit the foramina, the size of the foramina can vary. So traditionally, many of us are taught to instrument a tooth to a particular size because someone told you to do so. And that's kind of wrong because you can't standardize the size to which you instrument an individual apex on a tooth because they vary. So we have to try to keep the apex to the point of where nature created it, and not to overblow it out and to make it too big, or conversely, not to seal an apex that hasn't been properly instrumented in a cornfield that is too small, let's say, for that particular apex. So that's where the gauging comes into play. And one thing I want to mention is when you guys do, these days, I assume most of us do rotary endodontics, including myself, and I use the ProTaper Gold system. And I love the ProTaper Gold system because they utilize variable taper files. And what that means is the taper of the files, the way the files are designed, rather, is in such a way that each file will instrument a particular portion of the canal. So some of the files will instrument the coronal portion. Then the next file will instrument the middle portion of the canal. And then finally, they will instrument the actual apical third of the root system. And what that allows you to have is essentially a tapering shape. I like to think of it as a tornado almost. So in essence, when you instrument a tooth, many of us are taught we look for debris on the file. So if you're using the ProTaper system, you will notice, and many experts explain this in much more detail, that they look for the debris. And when you start to have debris on the apical area of the file, then you pretty much know that that file has cut the apical area, and that's pretty much when you can decide you're done. But however, it's further important to actually gauge that area with a hand file. And then when you gauge it, now you know, you're confirming that the debris you saw on the file is actually corresponding to a properly instrumented apex. And the way you do that, for example, if you instrument a tooth to a size, let's say, for example, 20 or 25, then you take an O2 taper standard file, you put it in the canal. I like to keep my root ZX or apex locator attached to the file, and I gently insert it to the proper working depth. But once the machine, the apex locator, confirms that I'm there, I give it a gentle tap with my finger to see if it's going to go deeper. If the 0-2 taper gauging file goes further past the apical constriction, as shown in your apex locator, then that's an indication that you should go to the next sequence in your system to expand it yet another size up, let's say to a 25 or a 30. And you can repeat the process until you see that the gauging file is corresponding to the finishing file that you last used. And then you seal the tooth. Now, we're traditionally taught to look for tugback. And tugback is certainly important. But very often, depending on how you do your endos, if you don't have the proper coronal flare of the tooth and it's not properly opened in the upper area, then you may get what's called false tugback, where the comb that you think you want to seal with may be giving you tugback, but it may not be coming from the apex. Therefore, I highly recommend to all of you to perform exactly what I just said. Before you decide to seal the tooth, place whatever corresponding file you feel is necessary, engage the apical area, and that will show you excellent results.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching in Action segment. This is Naren, your co-host. Before we jump into our Coaching in Action segment, I want to take a minute to thank Dr. Krastev for that wonderful tip. He has become a frequent contributor, and we appreciate both Gary and I, and of course our listeners appreciate you, Dr. Krastev. Thank you for what you do for the community, and thank you for helping our community, you know, continue to improve their clinical skills. Today's topic is tips to avoid the all or nothing case presentation dilemma. Tips to avoid the all or nothing case presentation dilemma. I love this topic because, you know, many of our listeners love learning. They are the type of people who are getting more than the required CE. They, you know, if your state says you need X, they'll get 5X because they love learning. They love being the best at what they do. So we have a very unique audience of people who love to learn, be the best at what they do. What that means is the more you learn, the more comprehensive your practice becomes in terms of the dentistry it does. And like all of us, when we know there is a perfect solution, we always share that perfect solution. But because a lot of dentists don't have the correct verbal skills, the patients are listening to it as it's either I have to do all of it or there's nothing I can do about it. And usually if that's what they feel and that's the choice they think they have, many times they're going to take the choice of, oh, let me do nothing. Hey, you know, we do surveys and we know all of you want to improve your case presentation skills. So you're going to love this episode. Hey, if you do love it, share it with your friends, post it on social media. So this might be one of our most downloaded episodes. Gary, take it away.
You know, case presentation is one of my favorite topics. I've had some amazing mentors in my life, and I have tons to learn still. I think learning more about case presentation should be a lifelong pursuit. And Aaron, I want to kind of piggyback on something that you said. I don't think dentists ever intentionally present it as all or nothing.
Right.
But that's how sometimes that's how the patient hears it. Right. Now, let me back up for just a minute. And can we agree that if the issue that's going on in the mouth is symptomatic, in other words, if the tooth hurts, case presentation is pretty easy. Wouldn't you agree?
100%. I mean,
so let's say you show up with a toothache, your cheek is, you know, swollen out 2 inches, and there's, you know, you haven't been able to sleep for 3 nights and a tear's rolling down your cheek. And the doctor says, Naren, would you like for me to get you out of pain? I think every patient on the planet is going to say, yes, now, please.
Exactly.
And certainly every office sees emergency type treatment. And while it may not be, you know, our most preferred method of treatment, I know there's a certain level of appreciation that you receive from your patients when you get them out of pain.
Yes. You
know, but as you advance your clinical skills and you're able to do more elective procedures, more complex procedures, we run into a dilemma of how do we present it to the patient in a way where, you know, it doesn't hurt, it's asymptomatic, and let's even say it's something more necessary, but it's asymptomatic. You know, I know all of our listeners see in every day situation in their practice, they'll see old amalgam fillings that are clearly failing. These are failing. But guess what, Naren? They don't hurt.
Right.
And so what might be going through the patient's mind if it doesn't hurt? What might be going through their mind?
It's like, it's nice to have, but I don't need it.
I don't need it.
Yeah.
It doesn't hurt. You know, and so it can come up even a situation like that. But as you learn more complex skills, how do you present ideal treatment, you know, in a way that doesn't result in all or nothing? Because if we accidentally present it in a way that's all or nothing, I can assure you, you'll get a lot of nothing. And that can be deflating. And it's kind of a bit of a downward spiral, because the more times you get nothing, it can psychologically affect you to say, well, I'm just not going to present that ideal stuff anymore. I mean, how many times do we want to bang our head against the wall?
Right.
So I'm going to share some tips that I've learned over the years, and I've learned from some great mentors on how to avoid the all or nothing case presentation dilemma. And one of them, I want to give credit to this one because it comes from my dear friend, Dr. Leanne Brady. Lee has been a guest on the Thriving Dentist Show. If you'd like to hear her podcast, just go to thrivingdentist.com, hit podcast, and you can search for Leanne Brady. Lee has also contributed, like Dr. Krestev has, in clinical tips. Lots of good content. Lee is the clinical director of the Pankey Institute, one of my very dear friends, and I want to give Lee credit for this. And one of the things that she does, and she does it so well, is to invite patients into a conversation about comprehensive care. Invite them into a conversation about comprehensive care. Now, Naren, just in that phrase, doesn't that sound kind of cool?
Absolutely. I think what I like is when we are invited into a conversation, we feel like we have a choice, right? As opposed to when we are not, we feel like somebody's shoving something down our throat that we didn't even want in the first place. So I love the invitation part, and I love the conversation, because it's a great term, you know, words just that's about, you know, what the patient wants, putting the patient first.
You know, the traditional method of diagnosis and case presentation has, and that was taught in dental school, identify a problem, present a solution. Identify a problem, present a solution.
Right.
The problem with that is there's a bridge that's missing between problem and solution. And that is, does the patient understand the need for a solution? And a second bridge that needs to be built there is, do they understand the benefits of the solution?
And I also think when you invite somebody into a conversation, they trust you more, right? As opposed to you preach at them. I mean, like, you are a coach, Gary. You go in and tell clients, no, do this. They're not going to listen to you. But if you invite them, listen to their challenges, listen to what's keeping them up at night, and then you are presenting your solution, they are much more likely to listen to you, because they feel like you really are here to serve them, as opposed to you are smarter and they are dumber and you're trying to push your smart ideas onto the dumb person on the other side.
Yeah. You know, and you know, inviting patients into a conversation about comprehensive care, here's how that might sound. So, Naren, let's say you're the patient and you've got a lot of issues going on in your mouth, but nothing hurts, but you've got a lot of issues. And, you know, we might say something like this. A doctor might say something like this to you. Naren, it's so nice to meet you today. You know, we welcome new patients in our practice. I'm honored that you've chosen our practice. Myself and my team are going to work really hard to take great care of you, take care of you like we would take care of a family member. You know, Naren, as I look at the photos and some of the records we've taken, the x-rays and the photos, I can see that you've had a lot of different dentistry done over the years. And I do see some concerns in your mouth. And with your permission, I'd like to invite you into a discussion, you and I, to discuss some possibilities for your dental health and how we can identify some potential problems and provide treatment that allow us to keep your own natural teeth all your life, so you can have a beautiful, healthy smile throughout your entire life. Now I'm starting to talk to you about the benefits of treatment. And with your permission, I'd like to share with you some things that we could do so that you could get those kind of outcomes. Is that something that you would have any interest in?
Absolutely.
And again, it's rather low risk here on the patient's part. Sure, because they've likely never heard that before in a dental office. You know, and if they have a bunch of patchwork dentistry, because, you know, and the doctor might even say, Naren, I can keep patching you up like clearly has been done in the past. Now, we're not throwing any dentist under the bus, you know, but we're just saying I can patch you up like it's been done in the past, or we could develop a plan to avoid more complicated problems in the future. Another way to start talking about benefits.
And so this is something, Gary, you already touched on, is understanding the patient's mindset. Some people don't care about their smile. Some people, it's really important to them. Some people, their oral health is super important because they have all kinds of issues in their family. And I know in your new patient conversation, I know you talked about finding out how they feel about these two, you know, questions.
Right. Well, co-discovery, you know, if you're a regular listener, you heard an episode recently with myself and Dr. Paul Henney talking about co-discovery. Co-discovery is where you and your patient co-discover together what's going on in their mouth, and you co-discover together what solutions might be to address any problems they have in their mouth. So the concept of co-discovery comes in here as well. If you haven't heard that episode, it's recent. It's within the last three or four. Download that one and listen to what Paul and I talked about co-discovery. Very cool information. So my first tip on avoiding all or nothing is to invite patients into a conversation about comprehensive care. Make sure you talk about the benefits. Naren, I can keep patching you up like has been done in the past. And that's, you know, that's certainly an option. Or we could gather some records and you and I can together develop a plan with a goal of helping you keep your teeth all your life, helping you have strong teeth and gums and getting all the benefits of that for the rest of your life. So a conversation about comprehensive care. Let me go to the second tip. Sometimes it's we have an ideal situation. Like, let me give you a case in cosmetic dentistry. I think our doctors that are very involved in cosmetic dentistry would love to do more smile design cases. Smile design cases would be typically an 8 or 10 unit upper anterior porcelain veneer case, 8 or 10 unit upper anterior porcelain veneer case. The average fee nationwide today for a porcelain veneer is about $1,500 as the time you're listening to this. So if we do a 10 unit case, Nairn, run my math for me. How much does that cost? 10 unit case.
When you say cost, meaning like lab and so forth?
How much does it cost the patient? $1,500 a unit.
Oh, $15,000.
$15,000.
Mm-hmm.
So we present a porcelain veneer case to the patient. And what might a lot of people say? Well, how much does that cost, Doc?
Yeah. And then you give them the answer and they might say, oh, it's too much. I can't afford it, et cetera. That could be one of the options.
They might be thinking, I've got some other priorities I need to spend that money on.
Right.
So if all you're offering is porcelain veneers, then it might result in a lot of all or nothing. And yeah, I would love to do a porcelain veneer case, but many of our clients are involved with the AACD, the American Academy of Cosmetic Dentistry. Right. And it's useful to have a tool belt that has multiple tools on it. For example, let's say the patient, what they want to correct is spaces in their upper arch. They have spaces in their teeth. Then another possible solution would be direct composite veneers. So it's not lab fabricated, it's direct composite veneers. And that can be provided to the patient at a much lower cost. That could be provided, again, you come up with your own fees on that, but a typical fee for that might be let's say we're going to do 8 units in the upper arch with direct composite veneers. That might be a $3,200 fee. And there's a lot of people that would like to move forward with that treatment if they were a candidate. Not everybody's a candidate for it. It needs to be additive dentistry. It can't be reductive dentistry. It's got to be additive dentistry if they have to have spaces. But let's say the condition was they had spaces. So then if the patient says, well, I just don't have a budget for that. You can usually see the color go out of their face when you present the $15,000 fee. And then it's like, oh, I can't do that.
Right.
But if there was an option, if you had the skills to do direct composite veneers, you might say, you know, Linda, let me share with you another possible option for your clinical case. I presented the lab fabricated veneer case first because that would be ideal. That's what I would like to do for you. And that would be the best. However, let me share with you an alternative. Because the conditions we'd be correcting are spaces, I can actually do direct composite veneers that would also correct that. In fact, I have an electronic photo album here. Let me go through and show you some befores and afters. So imagine you had this electronic photo album. You pull up your iPad and you say, you know, and these could be all close-ups where the patient, you still want to have the patient sign a release allowing you to use their photos. But let's say you can say, here's where we started, here's where we finished, here's where we started, here's where we finished. And Linda's going to quickly see herself in those photos. And what is she going to ask when you stop talking? Well, how much does that cost, Doc? And you say, well, the treatment fee for your case would be $3,200. So now instead of I have to do $15,000 or nothing, they might be able to do a $3,200 case.
Yes.
One of the downsides of direct composite, I'm not a clinician, but I know a bit about it, is they're not going to last as long. And you can present that to the patient because they might say, well, why is there such a big difference? Well, these were lab fabricated and we have much higher costs, you know, in terms of the lab fees. These direct composite veneers don't require a lab fee. I do it all with materials we have in the office. There is some limitations. They're not going to last as long. The patient might ask, you know, how long are the direct composites going to last? And then again, doctor, you'll have to answer that yourself. But one of the ways you might answer that is to say, well, it depends on you, Linda. Depends how well you take care of them. And also depends on how well you do about keeping your appointments in our office so we can help you take care of them. But I would be thinking in terms of 5 to 6 years for direct composites, and it could be longer. And if this was true, you might say, in fact, we have patients that are in their 10th, 11th year of direct composites, so they're holding up just fine, if that was true in your practice. Don't say that if it's not true. But be thinking in terms of 5 or 6 years. And if you get more than that, think of that as a bonus. And again, answer that however you like. But I would encourage you to answer it in the beginning with it depends on you. So they know they have some responsibility. And now all of a sudden, it could be seen as much more viable for them. What we've noticed in my client base is that patients that do direct composite veneers very often upgrade to lab fabricated porcelain veneers way before the direct composite veneers have reached their end of life, well before. Why do you think that happens, Aaron? Why do you think they upgrade to porcelain veneers way before the direct composites have reached the end of life?
I think they love the results and they want to, it's like a person buying a low-end BMW and then saying, oh, I want the best BMW.
They love the results. People say, I love your smile.
Right.
And now she thinks I want a more longer lasting solution.
Right.
You're right. They got to test drive it.
Right.
Now they want more. So I'd like you to think about other areas in your practice where you could offer clinical alternatives that are, less expensive than ideal. Less expensive than ideal. And by the way, if you're really skilled at doing direct composite veneers, I could show you some photos side by side of lab fabricated case direct composite. And without magnification, you might not be able to tell the difference. There is a difference in terms of the polish, the way lab fabricated veneers polish up. They do have a more of a sparkle. But for a lay person to look at it, because many times people don't necessarily want ideal, they want better. Right? They want better.
Right.
So think about that. Think about that. They want they want better, not necessarily ideal. So another solution to avoid the all or nothing. A third one, learn how to successfully phase treatment in. So you don't necessarily have to do it all at once. There are some great resources, great mentors that can show you how to phase even some of the most complex clinical cases. I think of people like Dr. John Coyce, Dr. Frank Spear, Dr. Leanne Brady. Pankey Institute, Spear Education, Coyce Center, great places to learn. I remember I had the privilege of speaking with Dr. Coyce one time on a program. And Dr. Coyce said to the audience, with the proper materials that we have today, you can phase in virtually any case. So now, Naren, if we had a $40,000 restorative case, I'm making up numbers just to use an illustration.
Right.
At a $40,000 case, what's going to happen if we present $40,000 to a lot of people? And let's say they have a desire. They know it doesn't hurt, but they want to correct it. And they find out the fee is $40,000.
I mean, I'm a math guy. So if I were to use the percentage, you'll get a low percentage of the people saying yes. So maybe I'm picking up a random number, 1%.
Let's say. And maybe you're, Sylvia is thinking, remodel the kitchen or do this restorative, remodel the kitchen or do this, right?
Right.
Or
right.
New BMW or do this, right? But what if we could phase that in by quadrant? What does the first phase cost then if I'm dividing it by 4, Naren?
$10,000.
Guess what? All of a sudden it went from there's no way I could do that. Wait a minute, I could do that.
Right.
Now, granted, they're going to have to go through and complete it, but they're going to be able to phase it in and phase it in a way that works for their budget. So learn clinically how to do treatment, even in the most complex cases where you can phase it. Now, there could be a very stray case, although I think Dr. Coyce would say, I'm not sure, Gary, but there could be a stray case where you can't phase it in. That's possible. But Dr. Coyce said, virtually every case, given the long-term temporary materials that we have today, almost every case can be phased in. Then all of a sudden, it becomes a $10,000 start instead of $40,000, which can become a whole lot more viable for patients. Now, let me close with one more tip. Be thinking about when you're presenting dentistry patients, be thinking about meeting them where they are. That's part of the co-discovery process, meeting them where they are. And Naren, I'm going to share with you a way we could do this with you, Naren. And I'm going to make up some situations that don't necessarily apply to you, but they could very much apply to any patient in a practice. And it would go something like this. I'm the dentist and I can clearly see you have a lot of issues in your mouth. There's a lot of things going on in your mouth. You've got a lot of patchwork dentistry. Nothing hurts, but there's a lot of issues. So watch this, Naren. I'd like you to interact. We didn't role for the full disclosure. We did not role play this. Naren does not know what I'm going to do, right?
It's a surprise.
All right. Here we go. So I'm a little nervous because I'm not sure what I'm going to get back, but we'll see. So, Naren, first of all, I've appreciated the chance to meet you today. I'm honored that you chose our office for your care. We're going to work hard to take great care of you. You know, as I've looked at some of these records, it's clear to me, and it's perhaps known to you, that there's a lot of issues that are going on in your mouth. There's a lot of things going on. But before I present solutions to what's going on in your mouth, let me ask you a question. You shared earlier, Naren, that you recently started a new job. You shared that with me. Now, it's been a long time since I've started a new job, but I remember the last time I did, there was a lot of moving pieces in my life. So with the fact that you just started a new job, is now the right time to address the issues that I see in your mouth ideally? Is now the right time to address those ideally?
No, you know, I might say something like, well, I have two kids in university. I have big bills to pay.
So it's more than that, Gary. It's not just a new job. I got two daughters in university. We are considering a remodel in the house. I've got to put a new roof on. Right. Now is not the right time.
Right.
Okay. Very possible, right?
Right.
So what am I going to say? Naren, I completely understand. None of this needs to be done right away, but I would like to address it with you. So we can, you know, help you keep your natural teeth all your life, have a beautiful, healthy smile when you're ready. Let me suggest we do this, Naren. I'm going to suggest that the best approach would be for us to schedule you for your hygiene appointments in our practice. And I'm going to ask you to be faithful about keeping those hygiene appointments. You have healthy gums, so that means we're going to see you every 6 months. And I'm going to ask you to be faithful about keeping those, because we'll kind of keep you in a holding pattern here. When you come in for your hygiene appointments, I'm going to come in and do an exam. I'm going to take a look and see how things are going and make sure that things aren't slipping to the point where we need to do something necessary. And then we can address the issues that are going on in your mouth when the timing's right for you. Naren, how does that sound?
That sounds perfect.
It's kind of like I want you doctors to think about it. Think about an ideal outcome and a minimal outcome. On the other side, the ideal outcome is, so what could be an answer of saying, in this case, what could be an answer? Naren, you shared with me that you recently started a new job. And it's been a long time since I've started a new job. But when I did, when I go back in my memory, I remember there were a lot of moving pieces in my life at that time. In reference to you starting a new job, is now the right time to address these issues ideally? That are going on from an ideal perspective. Is now the right time to address it ideally?
Absolutely. I'm ready. Actually, I need to address these issues because I think it'll also help me with my job.
Yeah, you might say, you know, my new job is customer facing.
Right.
And I'm more concerned now about the appearance of my teeth because of the fact that I'm front and center with customers all the time.
Right.
So you might say that, right?
Right.
But if I don't ask the question, I'm not going to find, is now the right time? People might say yes. Yeah, as a matter of fact, that's why I'm here.
Right, exactly.
Right? So surprised if they say no. If they say no, as a matter of, you know, really, it's not. Then have a minimal outcome that you're, and the minimal outcome would be to get their commitment to keep their hygiene appointments. And that's a great outcome because now I've got a patient. Now what I've done is I planted seeds, and now those seeds are going to germinate over time. The way a lot of complex dentistry gets done is that last method, is by planting seeds, letting the patient know we're ready when you are, and I'll be coming in and seeing you during those hygiene exams so I can give you a progress report on how things are going. If things are backsliding, I'll let you know, but hopefully we'll try to prevent, you know, anything becoming absolutely necessary, and we can treat it more ideally when you're ready. And how do you think, what lands on the patient's ears when we say, when you're ready, we can address that? How does that feel?
You know, I think the number one reason, whether I have loved a dentist or, you know, really left that dentist after my first visit, is the question, do they care about me? I think everything you taught today, it's all about the dentist, making sure the patient knows you care about them. You care about their finances. You're listening.
You listen.
You're not saying you should do this. You know, you're literally coming from them. Where are they? And everything starts with them. I think it's a fundamental thing, Gary. I think it's just such a big difference between the amazing dentists I've seen in my life and the ones that I wish I'll never see again.
Well, remember that point. I learned it first from Dr. Pankey. Meet patients where they are.
Right.
Meet them where they are. All right, Nara, we've got some great questions coming up. Let's hit pause on coaching in action and get to that Q&A segment.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. I hope you enjoyed the coaching in action segment, tips to avoid the all or nothing case presentation dilemma. I loved it. I think this is going to be one of our best episodes ever. So Gary, thank you for that. I have four questions from our audience from all over the world. Let me start with the first one. Do you recommend presenting treatment plans for more complex treatment at the end of the new patient appointment or bring them back for a separate presentation appointment?
You know, like an appropriate answer for so many questions is it depends. It depends. And I actually think you could, it can be done successfully both ways. But one of the things I want to think about today in answering that question is this is a universal. I have to use universals very carefully, always or never. You know, rarely is something always or rarely is something never. But I believe what I'm about to share with you is a universal. What is everybody on the planet's most valuable asset? Everybody on the planet, what is their most valuable asset?
Time.
Time. Time, right? And, yeah. And that applies whether you're a college student, a retiree, or an executive.
Yes.
Your time is you know, the college student has no time. You know, they need more time. The retiree, you know, while we might like they've got all the time in the world, no, they've got a lot of things they're doing too. And certainly the mid-career executive, you know, time is an issue. So I think whenever we can save a visit to the patient and present care to them at the end of that first appointment, that can be done just fine. That can be done fine. And there may be cases where you want to bring the patient back for a separate, you know, a separate case presentation. But I'll share something with you that may sound a little counterintuitive. This is something that I learned from Dr. Gordon Christensen. For a long time, you know, Gordon's a prosthodontist, so pretty much everything he does is pretty complex. Gordon used to have a protocol where patients would come in for the records appointment, and then he would bring them back to share his findings and present dentistry in a separate visit. And he started to notice that some of his patients were coming a long way. And they were driving, you know, in some cases, 2 hours, 2.5 hours, one way to come to see Dr. Christensen because he's very well regarded. And if they have to come a second time, if it's a 2.5 hour one-way trip, that's 5 hours each visit going to and fro, right? Well, Gordon is one of the most considerate people on the planet. If you ever met him, you know exactly what I mean. He and Rella are just dear, dear people. And Gordon started to think, maybe I should save my patient 5 hours by presenting the dentistry the same day, even on complex situations. And one of the things that Gordon discovered was his case acceptance went up.
Mm.
And so he said, you know, there still are cases where he brings the patient back in certain cases, but most of the time he's presenting the dentistry right to him today. And he commented to me, he said, Gary, one of the things that I think happens when you do that is you're exhibiting confidence. Does that make sense, Darren?
100%. I think the other thing, of course, being
you know what you're doing. It's like, this isn't my first rodeo. You know, I've seen this kind of situation before. And here, when I see this, this is what I'd like to do.
And I think going back to Robert Cialdini, right? He talks about the moment, right? People are three times more likely only in the moment. The day they discover they have a problem, that's the day they also are more likely to say yes to your solution. Not 5 days later when they have to now remember what the problem even is. So they're not as excited as, you know, they were the day they discovered it.
A possible exception would be if you genuinely want to think about the different ways you might treat it, the different ways you want to think about it, give it some time, then bring the patient back for a separate a separate presentation appointment.
Right.
But I think you'll find that much of the time you could do it the same day, save their most valuable asset, which is their time.
100%. Let me ask you the second question, Gary. What is the best way to let new patients know, or even existing patients know, the full range of services we as a practice can provide?
Oh, what a great question, Doctor. Thank whoever asked that question. Thank you. Because we're not going to put a menu. We're not going to have a menu. Can you imagine, Naren, if you went to a restaurant, there's no menus. Yes. And the server came, you know, it's not even the digital menu, you know, like they have now.
Right.
And server comes up and says, what would you like? What are you going to say?
Okay, what do you guys have?
What do you have?
I mean, the best menus are the ones nowadays, like some of these restaurants have iPads and they have pictures and
right.
It's beautiful, right?
Yeah, I want this.
Yeah, exactly. It looks so nice and I want it. Yeah.
Yeah. So we're not going to have menus in a dental office because it doesn't make any sense. But one of the things we could do is we could take beautiful after photos of patients that you've helped have ideal dentistry. And you could put those up in the clinical area of your practice. And when we do the tour, we could stop at one of those photos and we could say, you know, Naren, we love helping our patients with everyday general dentistry, but our doctors also have advanced training in things like dental implants, adult orthodontics, cosmetic dentistry, and other services like those. And we love helping our patients with those needs as well. In fact, all of the photos you see back here are actual patients of ours that we've helped have the smile of their dreams. Now, that patient knows now that we do dental implants,
right?
We do adult orthodontics, we do cosmetic dentistry. And maybe that patient is a younger patient, says, you know, my mother is missing a tooth and she's wanting to have it replaced with a dental implant. Now, what would be the perfect thing to respond to the patient saying that? We would love to see your mother as a new patient. Please invite her in. We would love to see her.
Right.
But if I back up, Robert Cialdini, you mentioned his name earlier, and he's written two New York Times bestsellers. First one is called Influence.
Right.
He's an author that chooses to write, to title his books with one word. His first one was titled Influence. Must read. Second one, also a must read, New York Times bestseller, titled Persuasion. So how can we persuade people to help them understand what is available in your practice before they come in? And the answer is your website.
Absolutely. Your website.
So now we could have a website that has many, many, many pages and many landing pages focusing on the various services you'd like to educate people about and you'd like to inform people are available in your practice. So you might have landing pages around dental implants, might have landing pages around adult orthodontics, landing pages around complex restorative dentistry, around cosmetic dentistry.
Veneers. You can have like all kinds of landing pages.
Crowns. But now let's back up even further and say, how do we get them to your site so they can see these brilliant landing pages? And we do that through mastering organic search engine optimization and having your website programmed with keywords and key phrases. So if they type in, I don't like my smile, what options are available? Then your website will show up in a Google search because of the way your website is written and the way your website is coded. Now, Naren, I'm deep into your territory now, but does any of this make any sense?
Oh, 100%. Like, let's take an example, implants, right? So there might be 30, 40 different keywords and phrases. These are typically like 3-4 words that somebody might type in. So for example, they might say, best dental implants, dentist, Phoenix, or city name, or zip code, or county name. They might type in implant before and after pictures near me. So it doesn't matter what they're typing in, you want you to show up. So
let me go a little bit abstract about that. How long do dental implants last?
Yes.
Might that be a term? Less obvious, but might that be a term?
100%. Even like, you know, implants gone wrong, because there are some people who are like worried about what could go wrong. So they want to see what might. So again, sure. You might rank for that and you can talk about how perhaps you took somebody who had a bad case and now how you totally changed the smile, you know, so you can have a pictures for that.
Right. The veneer case, you know, how long do veneers last?
Mm-hmm.
Would be an example of that. Well, Naren, I'd like to invite any of our listeners, with your permission, to have a marketing strategy meeting done with Lila at Equa. So Most of you know that Naren is the founder of a digital marketing agency called Equa, EKWA. They're the agency that I've used at LifeSmiles for now over 6 years with brilliant results. After a year of working with you and seeing the great results, I started recommending you to our clients, and especially those clients that are looking at reducing insurance dependence, because we've got to replace patients we're going to lose, and we often have to replace the historic flow that has come in from, say, Delta, because that's going to go away once you leave their network. And the answer is to replace Delta with Google. And you guys are the masters of this. So if you'd like to learn how Equa can help you with that, you can schedule a marketing strategy meeting. It's equa.com/MSM. And in that meeting, Lila Stone will share with you how Equa can help you with all of your marketing, your digital marketing needs, especially mastering search engine optimization.
Absolutely. Thank you, Gary. And we would love to review your marketing and give you some pointers as to what you're doing right, perhaps what you can improve, and also give you a plan. So it's a great use of your time. EKWA.com, MSM, once again. Gary, I have question number 3 for you. Have you found any good payment options for patients to finance bigger cases?
You know, Naren, this is a really important question because first of all, do you know offhand what the most popular vehicle by sales numbers is in the United States? What vehicle has the highest volume of sales in the U.S.?
I think Tesla is catching up, but I think it's still Honda Civic or F-150, one of those two.
Ford F-150 pickup.
Okay, Ford, okay.
It's a Ford F-150 pickup. Now, F-150 pickups range on a base model from about $30,000 to you can pay as much for the Raptor, you can pay as much as $97,000, believe it or not, for a Ford F-150 pickup. The Raptor is pretty cool. But if the only way to buy a Ford F-150 pickup was to walk in with cash or check to pay for it, you think that's going to be the number one seller anymore?
Not really. Probably they'll spend 10% of what they're selling right now, if that's the only choice.
No, in fact, it would be a small single-digit percentage of sales.
You're right.
Because how do most people buy a car?
They finance it or they lease it.
They finance it. So what's more important to them?
It's the monthly cash flow, right?
Monthly payment.
Monthly payment. That's all. As long as they can afford that, whatever the monthly payment is, they're buying the car because they love it.
Let's say we do a mid-trim model. I'm not sure what that is in the F-150. Let's say we do a mid-trim model, and you know it's $42,000, but you can have it for $395 a month.
Yeah.
I'm in. That's going to be most patients' response. Oh, I can do that. So, but in dentistry, what is it? You know, it's $40,000 or
nothing.
Come back when you have it.
And you have $40,000 saved up.
And we don't say that, but basically that's how the patient hears it.
Right.
I have, most of you know the common, payment options, care credits, fantastic, wonderful option. But if you're looking for an option for bigger cases that might work, we have found a good solution. It's called Proceed, P-R-O-C-E-E-D. Naren, would you do me a favor and take a look real quick at the URL for Proceed? We'll just list it here. Proceed provides financing up to $75,000. So it's really ideal for those bigger cases. They'll go anywhere from about $3,500 on the low side to $75,000.
The website is called proceedfinance.com.
Spell it if you would.
Proceed, P-R-O-C-E-E-D, proceed, finance, F-I-N-A-N-C-E.com. Proceed,
so proceedfinance.com. And they have a kind of what they call a shared risk pricing. So what I mean by that is there's two levels of cost. One is the discount that you pay when Proceed provides the financing. And then the second is the interest rate that the patient pays. Now, this is non-recourse, meaning if the patient doesn't, once you're funded from Proceed, if the patient doesn't pay, that becomes Proceed's problem, not your problem.
Got it.
So it is non-recourse. And the pricing of it will vary on the patient's credit worth. The more credit worthy they are, the lower the discount you pay and the lower the interest rate the patient pays. The more of a risk they are, the higher the discount rate is and the higher the interest rate is. And there might be a point at which you choose not to offer it because it represents too high of a cost for you. But we have found it to be a really good, in my client base, we found it to be a really good use for that $15,000 smile, Naren. Right. By the way, they'll go up to 96 months in terms of the terms. So the 96 months allows it to bring it into a very low monthly payment. So take that $15,000 veneer case that we talked about in the coaching in action.
Right.
And she wants it because she wants the longer lasting results of the veneers, but doesn't have 15 grand. That's a great case to use because that could be spread out over as many as 96 months. And that payment is going to be somewhere around $250 a month. And guess what we did there? We just sold an F-150 pickup.
Exactly. I mean, you just made it easy for the patient to say yes. I think the beauty of payment options is you're making it really easy for them to say yes.
We have an option for just about everybody.
Right.
So there. Yes, the answer is proceed. I've been recommending that to our clients, been seeing very good results, and it could be that option for the really big stuff, but it also could be something in the interim, you know, the intermediate size like that that $15,000 veneer case as well.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the fourth question. This is the last one I have for you. I am in the design process for building a new office. Would you suggest including a consultation room, or is that space better used for another treatment room?
All right. This is a tough one. I want both. I want another treatment room because there's never enough. You always need one more treatment room than you're planning. So I want the extra treatment rooms. I understand the value of that. But man, I want a consult room as well. I personally think, even though it doesn't necessarily equate the same way, I think the consultation room is the most productive room in your entire office. And if you're a deeply ingrained clinician, you're going to say, no, the op where I do my surgeries are the most productive. What do I mean the consultation room is the most productive, Darren?
Yeah, I think the consultation room is where the patient goes from I'm not sure to yes, I want the treatment. So if you really look at the return on investment on that room,
yeah,
I think it can be hundreds of thousands of dollars in a year.
So if I had to choose between the two, between a mm-hmm. consult room and an extra treatment room, I'm gonna choose the consult room. But I would also say, but is there any way we could, you know, with the floor plan, get one more treatment room in here? I'd like both. Great question.
Just one follow-up question, Gary, real quick. On the consult room, the idea is you want to make it friendly and welcoming and easy for the patient to talk to you, right? And you to talk to the patient.
Uncluttered.
Any tips on like how to set it up? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You should have a round table.
Okay.
Not a desk. If you're in a desk, it reminds people of either, you know, going to the bank and begging the banker for a loan, or some people, it'll remind them of being called into the principal's office.
Yes, I remember those days.
So sadly, so do I. You don't want a desk. You want a round table with three chairs,
okay.
Because your treatment coordinator is going to need one chair. A patient's going to need one. And very often they'll have someone that accompanies them. If they're an older patient, it could be a spouse. If they're a younger adult, it could be a parent. Okay. But I would have a round table with three chairs. It needs to be very clean and uncluttered. I would like to see a large screen TV on one of the walls where you could pull up photos. And otherwise, a couple of really nice after photos of patients of yours, very nice after photos. And the other thing you might put on one wall is not the entire wall, but you might just have a few of your credentials. And I will tell you something that actually is really cool. This is in our consult room. I don't think it's an accident. Both Paul and Tim are Eagle Scouts.
Ha!
Are Eagle Scouts. And we actually have their Eagle Scout Award framed and put in the consult room. And I'm amazed at how many people comment on the achievement of their having achieved that Eagle Scout Award.
All right.
You know, they'll comment, you know, they'll say, wow, that is so cool. Both Dr. Paul and Dr. Tim are Eagle Scouts. How cool is that? My cousin's one, or my, you know, they'll comment, or if it's a younger parent, they'll say, my son is working on his. That's really cool. It just gives a connection.
Yeah. I mean, I'm a scout, but I was not an Eagle Scout. So I totally get it. I mean, once you're a scout, you feel, and if you know somebody, maybe your kid, your son, anybody. Yeah. That makes total sense.
Yeah. Yeah. But you might want to make it really clean, really simple, not cluttered for sure. What I described is exactly what ours looks like. A big screen on one wall, two beautiful photos of after photos of a patient, one male, one female. And then on one wall, we have a couple of credentials framed along with their Eagle Scout Awards. All right, we're coming to the finish line here. I want to take a minute and thank you, Naren, for co-hosting this. I want to go back and thank Dr. Pavel Krastev for his great tips. Go watch him on YouTube. He's great to watch in video as well. And I also want to thank Equa for all the work that you do to not only help us at Life Smiles, but help my clients consistently attract quality new patients. Also want to thank all of our listeners. We appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you for the privilege of your time. We look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.